fully trusting in his grace this hour. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom cometh, will your robe be white? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansions bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, victory in Jesus. My Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory. Precious blood atoning, then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me.
I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, his precious blood's atoning, and I repented my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. Love me, ere I knew him. All my love is due him. Plunged me to victory. Join me as we speak out our faith together this morning. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen and amen. You may be seated.
Just a... Oh. Yeah, go ahead, sister. I was following my bulletin and it's...
Good morning, everybody. I have been reading this devotional book from the TV series, The Chosen. And there was one devotional that really blessed me and got me to thinking. And so I wanted to share that with you all this morning. And it's the story of Zechariah ministering in the temple in the Holy of Holies, and the angel Gabriel coming and telling him that John, his son, that they would have, he and Elizabeth would have a son. So after that happens, a reporter is interviewing him. So the reporter, Zechariah, you have been a priest for many years. It's been said that you and your wife Elizabeth are righteous in the sight of God and observe his commands and decrees blamelessly. So why was it such a struggle to believe Gabriel when he announced that you would have a son? Zechariah says, well, first of all, having an angel appear before you is utterly terrifying, which I can understand. Furthermore, I was in the temple on official business performing my priestly duty. The last thing I expected was a personal encounter with the Archangel Gabriel. That comment hit me square between the eyes and convicted me about what do I expect when I come to church. And I have to confess, I haven't expected very much. So that's what I'm getting. It's not very much. So I want there to be audience participation. I've done this in my Sunday school class, so we had a really good discussion. But I would like to know, what do you all, and I think we need to hear what you all expect. We need to hear what us as church members expect to receive or see when we come to church. So, does anybody want to say anything? What did you say?
I want to see miracles.
Okay. Who else? Oh, you did you want to say something?
Yeah, I did, but that's okay.
I'll be back.
Well, I come to church to worship the Lord and to have an interaction and just be filled and restored and renewed. And I feel like as a church that it's something that we really come to be in His presence in a different setting. We're in His presence every day and all the time, but we just need to really come into unity and worshiping Him.
I expect to see God's kingdom come and God's will be done. And to me, that also means empty classes full and empty pews full.
Anybody else?
I expect to experience Jesus through fellowship. I have to have my Sunday hugs, and that's real special to me. Personally, I am blessed. I get my socks blessed off all during the week, many different ways, and I know that Jesus is with me, but here it's the fellowship and the love that I crave.
All right, stand up. Anybody else? Rick, did you or Kim? Okay.
Sometimes I expect to get my toes stepped on. Sometimes I expect to get challenged. Sometimes I expect to really worship during a song. Sometimes I expect to cry. Sometimes I expect to pray aloud. And sometimes I expect to see healings.
Anybody else?
Well, I couldn't hear everybody, but what I expect is to see the love of Jesus, and I do see that. And I find joy in that every Sunday when I come, because I do see the love of Jesus.
One more. A great repentance. Knowing the power of
just saying, repentance, I think, is a key, and it's always been a key to the great revivals. And I think, I'm always in need of repentance all the time, and I think we just need to do that, and the power of the Spirit will really come down. Probably everybody here is saved, and believes in Jesus, and He is our Savior, and He is the Lord, and all that, and we all know that. But sometimes we just don't give testimony and don't have that repentance. And I think that's a key. And the thanksgiving is another thing that we just need to really be thankful. I'd like to see everybody be more thankful, and I'm one that needs to be more thankful for what all we have. And thank God for all the things we have here in this country, in this church, and such a beautiful church and everything.
I think it is very important that we know each other's hearts. And we don't always share our hearts with the church family at large. And I just want to I just want to thank you all for sharing, because we need to hear what other people think and expect, and so we can agree and so we can be blessed by. And did anybody up there want to say anything?
Excitement.
Okay. Thank you guys very much. Let me pray. Father, thank you for these sweet saints that are filling these pews. And I thank you that you love every one of them. And you love every church member that's not here. And I just ask that you increase my expectation, because I want to see you move. I want to see you move in my life. I want to see you move in the lives of these sweet saints and in the life of this church. Amen.
Thank you, Karen. If the ushers will come at this time, while I'm thinking about it, Mike, I have a book you're supposed to read. So come get it during communion. If you haven't seen the movie Jesus Revolution, I recommend it highly. Several people have seen it, and so if you've seen it, raise your hand. And those of you who haven't can talk to them about what they saw. You were supposed to take your granddad Thursday when you went to supper with him. He forgot to tell you, I know, but that's all right. So let us continue to worship the Lord as we receive his tithes and give our offerings. Father, we do want to thank you for this time to worship you in tithes and offerings. And we thank you, Lord, that you have blessed us so incredibly. Encourage our spirits and strengthen us, Lord, for your service. And we ask and receive these things in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Lord invites you to his table. All of you who love him, who earnestly repent of your sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Will you take a moment and pray in silence? Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. And by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth the fruit of the vine. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Father Almighty, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Will those who are going to assist come at this time? Come and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
We have done. Omniscient, all knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Sins they are many, his mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the sins there are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins they are many, his mercy is more. What riches of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord. His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many. His mercy. Held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, and I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. You have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. You have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With earth, every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
All my life you have been faithful. Yes, amen. So, very, very good, right? Some of our neighbors in our community, they just don't see God that way because they've had a rougher life than the rest of us because we are so blessed, right? So the West Texas Homeless Network has asked for our help to help some of our neighbors. There's a whole pile of lists out on the back table when you leave today. And we're going to be collecting items for those neighbors like deodorant and soap and bandages and just the normal everyday things that you just go pick up at the grocery store and we don't even think about sometimes. But those are hard things for some people to get. We're going to have a collection bucket out in the narthex for the month of March. You can bring those things up there, and then the youth are going to help put those bags together so that our friends at the Homeless Network can pass those out to people that need that. So good. Thank you.
Amen. I'm going to do something different today. Is that okay? So several people have made this suggestion, and I just figured that you could sit in any five rows you wanted to, and I'll just move the pulpit closer to you, and then you'll be in the first five rows. So here we go. Hi, y'all. How you doing? I think I can see everyone, and everyone can see me. Whether that's good or not, I don't know, but nevertheless, there it is. And so here we are. God is just so good. You know, amen. I was thinking about it. Now, some of you have already passed your golden anniversary. This summer, well, actually this spring, I think this month, it's going to be 50 years since I've known Jesus as Savior. So, I'm excited about that. That's right. I knew Jesus before I knew Roxy. So, hallelujah. I guess we should just get started. I love the discussion about expectation. I talked a little bit about that last week. You know, what do you expect to have happen when you come on Sunday? You know, do you expect God to do something? I sure do, because all week long I've been praying for every one of you by name. Every morning I go down the list and, you know, the first thing I ask is, God, pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us. And then I ask him to give you wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of God as you come to know him better. And that you will know the power that is in the resurrection life. And that as Christians, we don't always take full advantage of. And some of you, I know about the issues that you're facing in life, and others of you, I find out afterwards maybe, but I pray about those things. You know, I pray about, well, Angie, I prayed about your back, and I know it's feeling better. And Pat, I've prayed for you, and Linda and Nelson for you, and Dorothy and Joe for you, and Paula and Richie, and even for you, and you're not on the list. This is kind of fun. I can get right in their face. Your grandpa said that he joined the church when somebody said, you ought to join the church. You ought to join the church. See, look at that. All right, you too. So, yeah, that was fun. I have no idea where I am, but here we go. I've been reading this book called The Bondage Breaker, and so there was a slide up there about that. There it is, by Dr. Neil T. Anderson. He personally knows Jesus right now because he's up there with him. And but anyway, these series of sermons have been inspired by what he wrote about, and so I'm going to continue to talk about those things. The other thing I want you to know is you have a choice. And so here's my choice. I choose to believe the truth of God's word despite what my feelings say. I choose to believe the truth of God's word despite what my feelings say. And we've been talking about spiritual battles and where they're fought. And we know that spiritual battles are fought in your mind. I mean, if you look at the temptation of Christ, did Satan really drag him all over 40 acres to, you know, to all those places? Or was that something that happened in the spirit, in his mind, that he was taken to those places? The scripture doesn't say, and you can believe either way, it doesn't matter. But the point is that the battle, he was in his mind. He had to choose to believe the truth of God's word and to speak that truth. So I want to tell you that you can win the battle for your mind. Now, we joke about that sometimes and say, well, I came to church and left my mind at home. But, you know, it's really important. And so I want to share 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. Here's what the word says. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretense that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Hallelujah. That's our job. That's what we're doing. And so I want to talk a little bit more about your mind. Now, Colossians 1, verses 12 and 14 says this, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints and in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. You know, God has qualified us. The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, the power of the blood working in our lives, and us reaching out to Christ in faith qualifies us for everything that God has for us, every treasure in heaven. I heard someone say, when they get to heaven, they didn't want to have a warehouse full of stuff they could have used here. He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness. I mean, you know, hell was not created for anybody. It was created for the devil and the angels that fell. It was not created for human beings. And so the only way, you know, that Monopoly card, get out of jail, free, do not pass go, do not collect 200, I don't know, whatever it says. This is get out of hell free for everyone who will take the offer and receive that. But he didn't just rescue us from the dominion of darkness for no reason. He's brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have our redemption and the forgiveness of our sins. So you're operating on a clean slate when you come to know Jesus Christ. and you're part of the kingdom. And so all the blessings of the kingdom, all the promises of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, folks, you're Jewish, okay? Just get over it. You are. You're part of Israel. So all the covenants that God made, we're part of. And the new covenant. And then in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 and 18, therefore, if is there anyone here? The rest of you aren't anyone? You got to think higher yourself, okay? Yeah, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come, and all this is from God. You know, it's by your faith that you've been saved, but it's a gift from God. You're a new creation. Instantly, automatically, right on the spot when you receive Jesus, you're new. You've experienced a new birth. You've died with Christ and you're risen with Him and you're living a new life. That's your position in Christ. That's who you are. It just takes 50 years to get all the other stuff out of you. That's transformation. But when it comes to getting saved, it's just God's grace and mercy. That's why Jesus was so kind to all those people who got caught in adultery or all the other things. You know, a stoner, Jesus. No. He offered grace and mercy. And then he expected you to grow up and follow the right way. And that's what he expects of us. Colossians 3, 1 through 3. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. You see that? Set your hearts there. Set your minds there. Why does he say set your hearts there? Because where your heart is, that will be where your treasure is also. And so if you don't set your heart in heaven and your mind in heaven, you're not going to be there. You're not going to have those heavenly thoughts. You're not going to have what you need to operate in the life that we are to live before God. Now, if those verses are true, and they are, because God's word is truth, then here's the question. How come we still struggle with the same kind of thoughts and feelings we did before we became a Christian? Now, some of us have been a Christian so long. I was thinking about this the other day. You know, somebody, it was last January 3rd, I believe. I was in a worship service. It was a Friday night. And somebody said, well, God wants to heal people who have a foot problem. And some people actually got healed because they said, yeah, I have a foot problem. Well, here's the deal. I've had a foot problem for so long I didn't realize I had a problem. You know? So I didn't raise my hand and go down front and get prayed for a foot problem. You know, because, I'll tell you how I know that worked. Can I tell? Yeah. Roxy was sitting there and she goes, my foot doesn't hurt anymore. You know? But I had dealt with this for so long, it just had become part of my life, and I forgot to look at that situation and say, hey, I need that. You know? You're just like, well, and that's how we do with a lot of things. We've carried it so long and haven't laid it at the foot of the cross and given up whatever that, I mean, Jesus is happy to take it from you. It's just that we enjoy having it. We must, because we don't give it to him. I don't know. That was free. I have no idea. Oh, yes. So then how come I struggle with the same thoughts and feelings I had before I became a Christian? You know, becoming a new creation is a spiritual birth. You're a spiritual baby. If you don't know what that is, just look right over there at that young baby in Caleb's arms. And yeah, and so you don't know how to behave, and so that's what your job is, the church, is to help us. But you can't point your finger and condemn. You've got to love us into that position and relationship with Christ. You know, you don't yell at a baby because it wet its pants, do you? I mean, you might scream because it's the 45th time you've changed the diaper that day, but you don't yell at them for that, or if they spill their milk. Oh, my goodness, when, you know, 2 years old, and they think it's funny because you're going, ah! I know nobody's ever experienced that. And so we have to grow up in grace, you know. And so we still need transformation. There are things that God has been working on you with that you have not been willing to give up. And so they remain there. But God gives grace and mercy at salvation. And transformation comes next. Now, I suspect every honest Christian has asked that question. How come, you know, I'm still struggling with these same things that I struggled with before I was a Christian? You know, our attitudes, our actions, our responses, reactions to life circumstances are greatly affected by what we believe about who we are. You know, there's a very logical reason why we still think and feel and too often act as we did before we were born again. And the mature know this, and we should remember. Proverbs 3, 5 through 7. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not in your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. You know, it's just really simple. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Again, that heart thing. And then don't lean on your own understanding. Don't do it the way that you always did before you came to know Christ. Don't do it the way the world does. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Even though we live in this world. And so, and then he says, not only that, but that's the negative, okay? Lean not in your own understanding, but do this. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. And then the negative again. Don't be wise in your own eyes. And then the positive, fear the Lord and get rid of evil. You know, whenever you're going to do something silly, I was going to say a different word, but I chose silly, the Holy Spirit is bugging you already. Isn't he? So listen to him. It's just that simple. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 to 12. Therefore, remember that formerly, you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves a circumcision, that done by in the body by the hands of men. Remember. Repetition helps. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenant of promise, without hope, without God in the world. Oh my goodness, lost as a snowball and you know where. But now you are in Christ. Now you are a citizen of Israel. You are partakers of the covenant of promise. You have hope and you are now in fellowship with God. What a transformation. During the early and formative years, some of us are still in our formative years, okay, it's all right. And during our early and formative years of our lives, we had neither the presence of God in our lives nor the knowledge of his ways. And consequently, we learned to live our lives independent of God. Now, some of you grew up in godly homes, and that's wonderful, and what a blessing for you. But here's what I want to tell you, okay? Until you received Christ as your own Savior, you were living on your parents' salvation and not your own. And you were ornery. Don't elbow your spouse. And it's just the way it is. Until you come to that place and know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're ornery. And after you get saved, hopefully God redeems the orneriness and you can use it in a positive way for the Lord. And since your life had neither the presence of God nor the knowledge of his ways, consequently, we learned to live our lives independent of God. And this learned independence from God is a major characteristic of what the scripture calls the flesh. You see, when you become a new creation in Christ, nobody pushed the delete button in your memory bank. Everything you learned before Christ, don't feel like I'm talking about you before Christ, okay? It's just this side and then that side. Well, some people, you know, I got to look up when I say things. They didn't push the delete button on your memory bank. Everything you learned before Christ, all you did and everything done to you. Now listen, that's important. All you did and everything that was done to you. Because some of us had terrible things done to us. And so, all of that and all the feelings that go with those things are still recorded in your memory. And the more traumatic it was, the bigger the recording is. So Paul they infect our attitudes and actions and responses and reactions to life circumstances and greatly determine our behavior. Paul encourages, saying in Romans 12:1, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship." This is another way of saying what Jesus said in Luke 9:23. "If anyone would come after me, they must deny themselves and pick up their cross daily and follow me." Paul goes on to say in Romans 12:2, "Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." If you want to know what God's will is, read his word. It's in there. That's why I've been encouraging you for the last 3.5 years to read the Bible with me every year. Now, if you have a different way you read through the Bible, that's wonderful. If you don't know, it comes out in the newsletter every month for the next month's reading, and follow along. It'll change your life. You see, even as believers, we can still be conformed to this world because we haven't laid those things at the cross and gotten the new behavior that God wants us to have. We must be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Now look, did you all know that there are strongholds of self-defense? Yeah. In our days before Christ, we learned many ways to cope with life or defend ourselves, which were not always mentally or emotionally healthy. And these unhealthy patterns of living are called defense mechanisms. Now, this isn't going to be a psychology class, but I am going to talk about them shortly. Okay? Their purpose is to keep us from getting our hearts wounded and hurt, because we've been wounded and hurt. And so we build this wall, this stronghold, so that nothing can get in there again like that and hurt us. We all have them. There are ways to avoid pain in our lives. And the unhealthy pattern of living we learned before Christ are certainly not congruent with Christianity. For instance, and I think there's going to be a list up here of these things, many people have learned to lie to protect themselves, because it's easier to tell a lie than it is to tell the truth. Other defense mechanisms include denial, and I'm not talking about a river in Egypt. Denial, I know it was sad, but you know, dad jokes, what can I say? Denial is a way to refuse consciously or subconsciously to face the truth because it's too painful. And then there's fantasy. It's escaping from the real world to avoid pain. Whether that's through the television, watching, what is that, Hallmark, or Home and Garden Channel, or whatever it is that you watch, okay? It's a way to escape and avoid pain. There's emotional insulation or withdrawing to avoid rejection and pain. There's regression. It's reverting to less threatening times to avoid pain, so you go back and you pretend like you're back here instead of where you really are. Displacement is taking out our frustrations on others to avoid responsibility and pain. Nobody's ever taken their frustrations out. That's pretty interesting. Thank you. Say amen or some, or oh me, I don't know. Then there's projection, which is simply blaming others to avoid pain. Oh, it's his fault, it's her fault, you know. And then rationalization is making excuses for poor behavior to avoid pain. Listen to what the apostle says in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 20 through 24. You, however, did not come to know Christ in that way. Surely you heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off the old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, and to be made new in the attitude of your mind, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. I'm going to tell you how to do this in a minute, but I want to pause here for a second and just say, look, did you realize that you were created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness? That's what God made you to be. And then he even gave you a way to get there, Jesus Christ. The healthy way to avoid pain in our lives is to hear and do what James tells us, James 5:16. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. And the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. It didn't say take out an ad in the Abilene paper to tell people what you did. It suggests that you get with somebody who knows how to keep their mouth shut and talk to them about your issue and have them pray for you. You see, we can't share our faults with everybody because they don't know how to be quiet. You know, there are certain people, nobody here, thank God, but I could tell them in other churches, I could tell them something, and within a week, the whole church knew. And I use that to my advantage. Sorry. Look, you confess your sins to each other and pray for each other Because there's not anybody sitting under the sound of my voice, whether you're here in the sanctuary or out wherever the internet is going, who hasn't sinned and needs some help. And it's okay. At least you're coming to get help. And then it says, see, the powerful tool that we have, the divine tool we have, is prayer. And the prayer of a righteous person will bring healing and wholeness. And it's very powerful and effective, and God listens to those prayers. You see, defense mechanisms are like what Paul calls strongholds in 2 Corinthians 10:3 through 5. For though we live in the world, is there anybody here not living in the world? Okay, because you need prayer if you think you're not. We do not wage war as the world does. We don't do it the way the world does. The weapons we fight with are not weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, because that's what those defense mechanisms and many other things do. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. And you can just quote that. I take that thought captive to the obedience of Christ. And if you'll do that when you're thinking wrong and the Holy Spirit's going, hey, you won't be thinking that thought anymore. Strongholds are fleshly thought patterns programmed into our mind when we learn to live our life independently of God. The way we see the world was shaped by the environment we were raised in, and hopefully it was a positive one, but sometimes it's not. But when we became a Christian, nobody pressed the clear trash button. Our old fleshly habit patterns of thought weren't erased. What was learned must be redeemed. If you've been trained wrong, you can be trained right. Yes, you can. If you believe a lie, you can renounce the lie and choose to believe the truth. Yes, you can. Can your mind be reprogrammed? Yes, it can. Repentance. We think about it in a wrong way, like, you know, we're evil. Anyone evil here? Not that you're going to admit. Yeah, you're not. You're a child of God in true righteousness and holiness. So repentance isn't coming to know Jesus Christ as Savior alone. We're way past that for all of you. You know Jesus as your Savior. You don't need to get him. You don't need to get saved again. What you need to do is start living his life in you. And so what happens is repentance really is to change your mind about what you're thinking about. That's all it means. Change your mind and then change your actions. And then God comes in and changes your heart. It's that simple. You know, change your mind about who God is and how much He loves you. Even in the midst of circumstances that are awful. God doesn't love you any less because you're going through a hard time. In fact, that's probably when He wraps His arms of love around you and holds you the closest. Paul writes in Romans 12:2, "Be transformed by the renewing of your mind." We can be transformed because 1 Corinthians 2:16 says, we have the mind of Christ. That's pretty scary, isn't it? You've got the mind of Christ. So when you're listening to the Holy Spirit, who do you think that is talking to you? You know, he's only going to tell you what he hears. And what, well, who does he hear from? God the Father, God the Son. We have the mind of Christ within us and Jesus' promise of the Holy Spirit's guidance. John 6, 12 through 14, I have much more to say to you. Aren't you glad Jesus has more to say to you? That he didn't quit just, you know, whenever that was. And yeah, much more to say to you. More than you can now understand or bear. You know, I just think about this. If God had told Moses all the stuff he had to go through in the wilderness, he'd have probably told God where to shove that chop. Yeah, in the trash, right? You guys get out of that. Yeah, he'd have said, no way. You can't bear all that God has for you on the spot. And so over time, the Holy Spirit teaches you. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears from the Father, and he will tell you what is yet to come. Amen. Oops. So, to be continued in 2 weeks. Well, now that you ask, I'll tell you. I'm going to see my granddaughter. I'm going to be gone this next Sunday. But I want you all to come because I have a special guest who's coming who's going to share the good news of Jesus Christ with you, Ryan Goodwin. And there's one other thing that I want you to know. I want you to meet him as someone who's going to share the gospel of Christ with you because he's running for mayor. And so I want you to know who he is. And for those who have an issue with that, talk to me later. So, yeah, we as people of God need to get involved in our city government. Amen. All right, I'm done meddling now. Yeah, I will. I'm not going to let Roxy have all the fun. So, we got a song to sing, so y'all stand up and join us.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
When with the ransomed,
when with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see. 'Twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Oh.
With the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see. 'Twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous.
Savior's love for me.
Amen. Go forth in peace. The love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion and power of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.